Yes, thank you very much, Jörn, for the invitation. Thank you, everyone. Yeah, listening to me, I hope, and that is why I wanted to be in live here, that we have also some question and answer or some discussion about certain topics. As what Agenda 2020+5 is, you all could read, but I would like to give you my background thoughts on Agenda 2020+5 related to IFA. Yes, first of all, congratulations to your new strategic plan. Currently, I'm writing a handbook on strategic planning for NOCs, which is a project from the European Olympic Committee. I think it is very important for Olympic Sports Federation to have strategic plans and updating them. And doing that, I'm also a lot reflecting Agenda 2020+5. Okay, let me start with some comments on Agenda 2020. As you all know, that was made by Bach when he started his presidency and concluded this last year by saying that, was it this year? No, last year, 80% are reached. So basically, there is a report about conclusions of Agenda 2020. And I remember very well in 2019, we were sitting in our commission meetings and Bach came in and always asked, or all the commissions, he asked, is Agenda 2020 done? Do we have to make it longer or do we have additional topics? And at that time, we said basically nothing in our sphere of legacy and sustainability could be added or should be added. It's now a matter of bringing it into action and work on communication. So this is how it ended in a way, but as you see now, Agenda 2020+5 was an initiative to collect all and more topics, challenging topics, which are currently on stage. So what Bach did was, and you probably also got the letters from him, he contacted everyone in the Olympic family and wider family to ask, yeah, if you want to contribute to the challenges in the after COVID-19 world, then please tell me how you think the world should look like. And from the many papers he got, they drew up 15 recommendations, and these are new recommendations, but the format is very similar to Agenda 2020. By the way, I'm using this format as well for example, the National Strategy on Mega Sport Events in Germany. I'm also in this group working with the German government. What I like very much is it is formulated like recommendations or like hypotheses. No, not hypothesis, like statements. And then later, the statements are formulated that you later can find an answer to that. So I think a very good way in strategic plans is then at the end to come up with 20 or 40 recommendations which you want to do. And then later you can check if you were successful in these. So therefore, the way of formulating Agenda 2020+5 with the 50 new recommendations is similar than it was done before. After reflecting the 15 recommendations, I thought 9 of them fit well with your federation. And that is, and I'm not going through all of them as you all have seen them, and we don't want to spoil our time tonight or this afternoon or wherever you are in the world to talk again about something that you can read. But I think it would be interesting to you maybe to hear my background thoughts, which are on the 9 topics, but a little more elaborated on the 5 areas which are really changing the world. So we can go quickly through the 9 recommendations I think are important for you. First of all, reinforce athletes' rights and responsibilities. So athletes as stakeholders are coming up more and more, and they are also challenging NOCs and international federations to get more power and say. So in order to not wait too long, athletes should play an important role in your organization. And I think also IOC will certainly look at this if they are not only representatives, but also if they can actively collaborate. As I don't know what you are doing in your federation right now, you may think, yes, Mr. Preuss, we are doing that already, so then it's absolutely no problem. But this point is something that the IOC brought up because more and more athletes unions are starting to exist. And just 2 years ago, the German Athlete Germany was founded, and they straight away went to Thomas Bach asking for 25% of the revenue. So they asked basically for $1.2 billion to be given to the athletes. They said, we are doing the games and we are the athletes. So certainly this couldn't be done, but that shows that athletes are coming up. And you could think also about other stakeholder groups that may come up after them. Second point that fits is continue to attract the best athletes to your fistball world championships. Certainly this is also what you do. There's nothing new. Third step, further. So for the IOC, this is important that it seems that sometimes not the best athletes are coming in golf or in football or in some sports. It seems, or ice hockey, for example, when the NHL was not participating in the last winter games. So there is a feeling that some sports think their athletes, they're not the best athletes are anymore at the Olympics. But if we reflect it to you, as you are not in the Olympic program yet, and if you are, then I think it wouldn't be any concern that the best athletes want to go there. Third, further strengthen safe sport and the protection of clean athletes. So safe sports, certainly, clean athletes, certainly. So everything related to doping and also the safeguarding of the athletes, sexual harassments and all the topics going on are certainly related to all federations. And therefore, this is something where you can be very active. Fourth point is coordinate the harmonization of the sports calendar, which is not important to you yet as you're not in the Olympic program, but still there is a lot of coordination with other sports. And from a marketing perspective, I would still advise, and I think you probably are doing that, where and when to put your world championships and big events to have a chance to be better represented in the media. Something like with the European championships, if you could join like the European championships, for example, there is a format where you can gain further awareness in the media, which is then interesting for the sponsors. So when this is written here in regards to Olympic Games and that all the international federations should harmonize their calendar to make it better feasible for athletes to attend the Olympic Games or not to, to have too much stress to their body, here, I think it could be from a marketing perspective, from a viewership perspective, from an awareness perspective, to either stick to a joint thing to be covered by this or stick to empty calendar parts. But certainly you have to harmonize your world championships with the European or continental championships and all the leagues, which is still what every federation is doing. Fifth, grow digital engagement with people. This is what is upcoming, digital engagement. So how can we bring additional information to the athletes? I will come to that point under digitalization a little later. So this is to me an important point, but I'm short here because I return to that point. Six, I don't know if you want to do that, but many federations are doing, encourage the development of virtual sports and further engage with video gaming communities. So that was a little surprise to me in a way that the German for NOC at least is not really happy to accepting digital sports and esports. But on the other hand, we know that the IOC, or I know that the IOC is very active in developing something in this regards, that the international federations with Olympic sports think, and that is also what you should think, at least when it is a sport like fistball, then the fistball esport application should be owned by the fistball federation and not by Sony or any gaming industry. So at the Youth Forum in Buenos Aires, at the Youth Olympic Games, at the Youth Olympic Games in Buenos Aires. Some of you may have been there. I was surprised that there were quite many from the eSport family there. You know, international eSport federations popped up. We have two now worldwide competing for international federations to become their members. So there is something going on which cannot be stopped. The question is if at the end esports is something like piano playing or culture or music, an own area where they have their own competitions and do something, entertainment of people, or if we have the esport application related to the Olympic movement. To say it again, the IOC is working on that, and our next worldwide case study competition, I'm just finalizing the next 2 days, will be related to esport, as this is a top interest topic of the IOC to at least be informed and be on the top of thinking what can be done here. My seventh point is strengthen the role of the sport as an important enabler for the UN Sustainability Development Goals. Yes, this affects everyone, as the UN Sustainability Development Goals are so broad, fight poverty, gender equity, that many of the topics are so normal that we are normal, so logic that we should fight for them, that this is not a special task for an international federation. I think this is our duty to what we anyhow do. So gender equity, I mean, we are not discussing here if we should have more male or female football players. I mean, we have the same, hopefully, number of teams and same status for male and female players, and also hopefully soon board members and so on, that certainly you are doing and work in these fields. I would suggest not to do something extra, as a small sport federation should better focus on their sport and sport development and their strategic plans, but look at the sustainable development goals and reflect what you are doing anyhow. And then maybe you can stress the points you're doing anyhow and write them somewhere that IOC, when they are looking at you or reassessing, then they see, oh yes, they do a lot in this regard. So the way would be what you do anyhow, you should mention in a very positive, you should mention as you're doing it, but not trying to achieve fighting poverty with the small resources you have in your federation. Eighth point out of nine, strengthen the Olympic movement through good governance. So what the other Olympic movement and IOC doesn't want is more international federations being in the media with bad news. So therefore, it is always good to do everything which is related to good governance. I think what there are several measurements out. Play the Game was doing one, or the ASOF was publishing one. There are so many different ideas how to do that, and I really recommend to you maybe to use the SIGGS, S-I-G-G-S, from the European Olympic Committee. It's in the internet. It's a self-assessment tool, which means you can put everything in anonymously and they assess you by computer, so to say, automatically, give you automatically recommendations, and you see already where you are. Because later, when there is a comparison among international federations, it would be good if fistball would be somewhere in the top third of international federations and not one of the last, because this is certainly not what the Olympic movement needs. And my last point, or the last recommendation from which fits to your federation, is certainly the innovative review generation models. And I come back to that also in my second part of my small presentation here. So the second part is about the key trends which the IOC thinks have been identified through the thousands of answers to Bach's letter and are likely to be decisive in the post-coronavirus world. And there are five trends. The five trends are obviously known by you as they are written in Agenda 2020+5, but I will repeat them and give my comments to them. First of all, the trend is the need for greater solidarity with, in, and among societies. This is a nice wish and demands that the stronger sports and nations help weaker ones to develop. I think for you as association, it is what new members at the new members, which with a solidarity lens, but keeping in mind that it should be subsidiarity help, so to say, only help those that are able to help themselves and support them appropriately. So help them to enable them to grow, but do not grow them. I think this is a common mistake that certainly the new and small federations want a lot of money, but the question is how effective can the money be? I very much like the grow concept of UEFA, for example. I mean, that's a big federation. We know they have a lot of money, but they have concepts, and that could be something in small you could develop. I know, dear Jan, and also Christoph, you have big eyes when I recommend all this thing. It's a lot of work, yes. I hope you have people helping you doing that, but to have a grow initiative to help smaller federations to grow, to show solidarity, but in a way to not just give them money and equipment, but also help them with the right topics to grow, or you may have that already. Second trend is the grow in digitalization. Digitalization, so now we come back to the point. And I think this is a trend that is very important for federations, as they need to also look into the digitalization and not into just computer stuff or what you may think of digitalization. I have put it to 6 points. First is what a federation could do is change their sports format. Not the traditional fistball, but think about what kind of different formats can we do additionally in the world of digitalization. I give you an example of modern pentathlon, where I'm also in the World Federation Future Commission. There we develop the laser run. It's running and laser pistol shooting. And you can do this running and shooting also independently in the corona world with in a competition with others, but individually. Or what about the VAR, video assisted referees, which National Football League has already for 25 years, and in football they just started. But what about this kind of technology? You may think it's expensive and we cannot afford, but it's just showing you how formats in sport change. Or what about speed mini golf, which is shown in Instagram? So the change of the sport format. Second area of digitalization could be the change of the field of play. I was quite impressed seeing volleyball and the information they used from Hawkeye. So you can look at www.hawkeyeinnovations.com if you have not seen that. And Hawkeye is collecting so many information that they can then have virtual support about the field of play. I know that you are thinking the same I am thinking. We are not so much in television, Mr. Preuss, that this makes sense and it's very expensive, but it's something to keep in mind. And the easier it gets, look now, our kind of conferences became so easy. My background, I hope you know that, it's the staircase of the IOC. It's so easy to match in. I can produce videos with green screen at home, and that has a quite good quality. So many things get easier in the next years, and that should just be in the back of your mind. Sorry, Jörn, if I'm too long. I know I'm probably too long, but you gave me up to 15 minutes. So I use the 15 academic minutes plus 15 you gave me. So then in 30 minutes, everything should be done. Third is the change of data about the match. Hawkeye also collects personal data about everything, how much the athlete moves, how often he or she jumped, the speed of the ball, and so on. So there are immensely many data, and I don't know how expensive it is to work with such a company. I guess the installation of the video cameras and so on is the most expensive, but there is an opportunity to collect many, many data. Fourth area to change could be a change to non-linear media. So as the IOC says, we want to be have people-centric content. So we want to have a content made about fistball for the fans, for the players, and for the fistball family and the general public, let's say. So, but we have different groups and we want to have content which could be seen non-linear, so not only in a live stream, but to be downloaded. So you need to think about what is the interest of your fans. And that leads me to, and now it becomes spooky, to cryptocurrencies. I was astonished when I worked into digitalization of sport federations that you can look at that tokens are given as a digital currency for sport federations. I can't recall if it was karate or judo, where they just have their web page, and if fans are at the web page and show a particular interest or knowledge about athletes or the sport or the rules or the last world championships and so on, they can earn tokens, and the tokens is your currency, as the token can be then changed into fan articles or a ticket for the world championships in Mannheim or whatever you want. So you give prizes from your sport, but they can be earned by tokens. The tokens are earned by looking deeper and more into your sports. By this, you educate hardcore fans to be more interested because they gain more knowledge and they want to be in your webpage and so on and learn about the federations and so on. And they can earn something, and then when they come, they have small benefits, which brings them closer to them. So this is in the webpage www.ex-sports.io. You can look into that to learn about cryptocurrencies of international federations. So I'm just giving examples of digitalization and international federations. Certainly, the fifth point is the digitalization in sponsorship. And the last step could be, and it's not too far, using blockchain in sports. Now you think, blockchain, what is that? Blockchain, as we hear it more and more, is a way where you can secure that a digital thing, let's say a ticket, is really a real ticket and not a fake ticket. So if you sell tickets, it could be, if it's in the blockchain technology, I know as Holger Preuss, when I buy a ticket, it's a valid ticket and it's not a false ticket. You may think this is not important to our sport yet, but we can think about collectibles and other things and just have in mind that blockchain is something protecting the originality of something in the internet if it's not touchable anymore. Because digitalization means we are without papers and without products, and I don't want to travel to Mannheim and be there without a valid ticket, for example. Okay, it's too quick maybe for Mannheim, but the next World Championships are coming up. Third trend. We have five, but now we are a little quicker. The third trend in Agenda 2020+5 is the urgency of achieving sustainable development. So now I could give you a long lecture about sustainability and legacy, as I'm in the IOC Commission. But sustainability here, which originally means economic, social, and environmental, I think we should focus on ecological sustainability, as I think social sustainability, fistball has no problem with human rights issues or construction and so on. So this is not so important. But when it comes to sustainability, there's a lot to do, and a modern international federation must have a good sustainability concept, looking in different dimensions, not only maybe waste reduction, but it could be transportation, communication, and education related to sustainability. And think about how FISBOL can be maybe climate neutral. IOC wants to be it in 2030, but what is your plan for 2040, let's say? IOC currently is working a lot with compensation in the Olympic forest planting in Senegal. I think this is overdoing it for FISBOL, but there are quite many concepts that can be done to reduce the harm for the environment through your competitions. Fourth trend, the growing demand for credibility, both of organizations and institutions. And I think this is key, not to be nice to the IOC, but it's key to attract sponsors, to attract governmental support, and at the end, fans and athletes. In many nations, the governmental support depends certainly on persons, and the persons have a view on an international federation. And if they feel there is no credibility, then it's more difficult to get money. Even in Germany, and Jörn was fighting probably for that, to get for the World Championships enough support, as we don't have the international the national strategy for sport events yet finished. He had to apply for money, and he can either get the normal amount of money or some extra, and the extra is dependent on the person who is giving the money, and this is not easy to get if the credibility is not good. I just finished a study and about federations and the reputation, and it's quite interesting to see that federations are seen as theoretic, boring, against human rights, not needed, corrupt. This is the corner where the DUSB, IOC, and FIFA is. So the problem is that the population puts all international federations into one bucket currently. Last point and last trend the IOC Agenda 2020 plus 5 is stressing is the need to build resilience, so resistance, so to say, in the face of financial and economic consequences that will result from the COVID-19 pandemic and which will influence priority setting among governments and enterprises. So it may become more difficult in future to secure all the money you need. And this is certainly the homework to do. How can you survive by trying to widen or to spread the financing sources you're depending on? I think, yes, this is what you do all the time, to not to be too dependent on one, but to help your member federations and also for the international federation to become in a way more independent or to learn from this crisis to what should be done to avoid if the crisis comes again. That's it from my side. I'm here happy to answer your question. And sorry for being so long, but that's a professor when he starts talking, he gives a lecture. Sorry for that and welcome for your questions.